Summer is a great season to observe and photograph objects in our solar system, whether that be the sun, the moon, and of course, the planets. This month in August, two planets recently made their closest approaches to Earth, and tonight I'm going to be photographing one of them. This is a planet that I photographed previously last year, and I'm hoping to make some improvements on it this year. So come along for another astrophotography imaging session as I revisit the crown jewel of our solar system, the Lord of the Rings himself, the planet Saturn. My name is Kwesi Akwa, and welcome to the Astro Park. Named after the Roman god of wealth and agriculture, Saturn is the sixth planet from the sun, as well as the second largest planet in our solar system. It's a gas giant with a radius about 9 times that of Earth, but a density of 1/8 the average density of Earth. So if you placed Saturn in a bathtub that was large enough to hold it, the planet would float. Saturn has a pale yellowish hue due to the ammonia crystals in its upper atmosphere. The planet's most famous feature is its ring system, which is composed mainly of ice particles and a small amount of rocky debris and dust. There are 82 known moons that orbit Saturn, with 53 of them being officially named. Saturn's largest moon, Titan, is the second largest moon in the solar system and is the only moon to have a known substantial atmosphere. Spacecrafts that have visited Saturn include the Pioneer 10 flyby in 1979 and the Voyager 1 and 2 flybys in 1980 and 1981, respectively. The latest spacecraft to visit Saturn was the Cassini-Huygens space probe, which entered orbit around the planet in 2004 and completed its mission in September 2017. Planetary astrophotography is a completely different ballgame than deep space astrophotography. You'll need to have a telescope that has a large enough aperture and a long enough focal length to see the best details possible. So, making its photographic debut here in the Astro Park, I'll be using the Celestron EdgeHD 9.25, a Schmidt-Cassegrain telescope. And for imaging, I'll be using the ZWO ASI 224 MC, a one-shot color planetary webcam. And as per usual, this will all be sitting on top of the Orion Atlas Pro AZ EQG mount. And since light pollution isn't that big of a factor for planetary photography, I'll be using the Optolong UV IR cut filter to help with the sharpening and contrast details. So, of all that being said, let's go outside, take a walk in the park, and get everything set up for tonight's imaging session of the planet Saturn. Hey everybody, so I just completed my polar alignment and star alignment procedures. So I'm getting ready to slew over to Saturn to start imaging, but I wanted to take a quick moment to talk about some of the accessories that I'm using for tonight's imaging session. Unfortunately, with the Schmidt-Cassegrain design, the downside is the corrector plate itself. It's usually one of the first things to either dew over if it's very humid or frost over if it's very cold. So if you have a Schmidt-Cassegrain, I would recommend getting a dew shield for it. So I have a metal dew shield for my EdgeHD. It's made from a company called AstroZap. And just like a refractor dew shield, it pretty much reduces the amount of dew that forms on the corrector plate and also blocks out any external light sources as well. Now, unfortunately, with the dew shield, although it can slow down the prevention of dew, it won't stop it altogether. So as a precaution, I also have a dew strap installed as well. So on the back of the telescope, I have a little bit of a different imaging train. So we have the camera as usual. This is the ZWO ASI 224 MC. And right in the middle, I have a device called an ADC. This is an atmospheric dispersion corrector. So where I am in Maryland, the planets usually get to about 38 to 40 degrees above the horizon. And at that height, I'm still looking through a good chunk of atmosphere. So that ADC can help minimize those aberrations. And I'll talk about how this works in a future video. And then the last part, I have my Barlow lens. This will increase the overall magnification and focal length of the telescope. So I have a 2x Barlow lens, so everything will be increased by a factor of 2. So with all that being said, let's slow over to Saturn and start up our imaging software for planetary imaging called FireCapture. Okay everybody, so I started up FireCapture. This is the acquisition software that I use for planetary photography. So right now you're actually looking at Saturn, believe it or not, but I actually have it overexposed. I have it overexposed for a particular reason. So I'm going to do my focusing routine. So one of the struggles that I've had with planetary photography is learning how to do proper focus. So I currently use the Batinoff mask method for deep space, and I tried using that for planetary, trying to focus on a star to get the full width half maximum, but unfortunately that method doesn't work too well for planetary astrophotography. So what we can do about this is we can still use the Batinoff mask method, and this works particularly well on Jupiter and Saturn. You basically overexpose the image and then use one of the planet's moons as a focal point. So it basically acts as a bright star. So you can put your Batinoff mask on and you should see that diffraction spike pattern, and then you can line it up accordingly to get the best focus. And also some people tend to use planetary features such as the Cassini division with Saturn, cloud bands on Jupiter, the Planitia fields on Mars. So there's various ways to do proper focus. So I'm going to apply my Batinoff mask, try and get focus, and I'll be back in just a moment. Okay everybody, so I completed my focusing routine. So you can see that bright dot near the upper right to Saturn, that's its largest moon, Titan. So I did my focusing routine on that. So now I'm going to lower the gain and see what kind of image we can get. And look at that, the planet Saturn just floating up out there in our solar system. If you've never seen Saturn through a telescope, this is definitely one of those items that you can check off of your bucket list because it's a very spectacular sight to see. So you might notice that there's a slight bit of wavering in the image. This is what's known as the seeing conditions. So it's best to shoot the planets when the atmosphere is as still as possible. So for me in Maryland, I get rather average to sometimes above average seeing. So if the atmosphere is pretty unstable, then you can't really do any imaging. But for now, it looks like the scene is relatively stable. There's a few wobbles here and there. So I'm gonna go ahead and take a test video. So these videos take a lot of exposures that are very short, usually like in the milliseconds, as opposed to deep sky, which can be into the minutes range. So the recommended record time for Saturn is about 90 seconds. So I'm gonna go ahead and press play and get our first video. Okay, so that's gonna be recording for the next 90 seconds, and then I'll just do a quick review once it's finished. And I'll take as many videos as I can where the atmosphere is as stable as possible. Hey everybody, so I just want to give you all a quick update. It's about 12:20 a.m. right now, and I've taken several different video captures of Saturn over the past couple hours. So I wanted to take some more time to talk about a couple of planetary tips I wanted to give. So I mentioned earlier that you want to have a telescope that has a large enough aperture as well as a long focal length, because when it comes to astronomy and astrophotography, aperture truly is king. However, there's also another saying that's just as, if not more important. The best telescope is the one that's used most often. So you can have the largest, most powerful telescope, such as the C14, for example, but as the telescope gets bigger, it gets heavier as well. So you might not be very excited to carry it to and from your observing site, unless you have a group of friends that are willing and able to help you out. So whatever size telescope you have, just use what you've got. It doesn't matter if it's 8 inches, 6 inches. I've seen some fantastic planetary photos with a 5-inch aperture. So just work with what you have, and always remember that the best telescope is the one that you use most often. And my second tip is you can view the moon and planets at any time during the year. However, the best time for viewing and imaging is during what's known as opposition. So when the sun is setting in the one part of the sky, the planet is rising in the other side. So the sun and that planet are opposite sides of each other, which means that the Earth is at its closest distance to that planet, giving you the biggest and brightest views of that planet. So in 2021 for August, Saturn's opposition was on August 2nd and Jupiter was on August 19th. So unfortunately I missed out on that due to the weather in my area, but I'm out here tonight and I'm making up for lost time. So that's always a win in my book. As much as I would love to be out here all night tonight, unfortunately, I gotta bring this session to a close. It's a little after 1 a.m. and I was able to collect several different types of video files for the planet Saturn. And hopefully one of these will have some good seeing conditions so I can create the best image possible. I had a lot of fun imaging Saturn tonight, and I really wish I could have seen it during its opposition, but unfortunately the weather didn't cooperate with me. But I was still able to come out tonight and it was still a really great time. So thank you for watching AstroPark. Please enjoy the image of Saturn at the end of this video. And until next time, take care, and I wish you all clear skies.